Aloha, Hawaii. I'm civil rights attorney Andre Wooten. And for Black History Month 2022, I was invited to speak to the Maui African American Association, and I took a long view of history, looking also at climate change over the last 10,000, 20,000 years. Come with us and take an international view of world and African American history. Mahalo. You know, on the North Shore, living on an island, the effects of climate change are very clear insofar as houses are sliding into the ocean as the ocean has eaten away at the sand, shoring up their foundations. Climate change is a natural phenomenon of the earth, which is caused by many effects, none the least of which are volcanoes and clouds. At the same time, the effects of human-caused carbon excesses is spurring change at a more rapid rate these days. If you look at the history of the Sahara and the Mediterranean over the last 1,200,000 and even the last 20,000 years, you see the clear effects of climate change as the rivers and lakes of the Sahara dried up, forcing the evacuation of the multitudes of people there. But they left evidence of their presence in the cave drawings that are found in the middle of the Sahara, preserved after 5,000 and 10,000 years. Come with us for an international look at the spread of people throughout the world over the long view of history. Mahalo.
There it is.
You see anything? Okay. Yeah, well, we're talking about the Ice Age, and we're talking about climate change here. Climate change has a lot to do with human history, you know, because when, you know, the ocean comes into your house, you generally have to leave, you know, and when the rivers dry up, you got to make some movements too. Now, this is not moving, so let me see here.
Arrow at the bottom, Andre, the four arrows pointing up, down, and south. No, don't touch anything over there, just your keyboard.
Oh, okay, this is great. So this is, you know, just another picture of the Ice Age, but you can see, gosh, you know, the west side of South America, you can see North America covered with ice, and just about all of Europe. So the you know, Africans were going from North Africa into Spain. I mean, Napoleon used to say that Africa really ends at the Pyrenees. This is an interesting article about the tsunami that went down in about 5 years ago. And the Ottoman people, basically survived because they, you know, could tell the signs in nature. But the Ottoman people have been in that area for about 80,000 years. And the government of India recognizes that they don't want any visitors. They kill visitors. You know, it's shucks. And the Fiji used to be called the Cannibal Islands in the old days, because if you weren't invited to dinner, you could be dinner. You know, and this is the old religious complex that we had the fortune, good fortune to explore. Narmamensis, the first pharaoh, started the first nation, came from the south of Egypt, because the Nile flows from south to north into the Mediterranean. And so anything up south just naturally just drifts down the river. And curiously, the wind carries the sailboats back up the river, and that's the natural way that, you know, the Nile moves. Representation of one of the grand temples in its prime when it was dressed naturally. Isis and Horus again. Isis, you know, was the grand temple of the Queen Mother. I mean, legends of Isis, you know, go back many, many thousands of years. And she had an immaculate conception of Horus because the brother of Osiris, her husband, murdered Set, a Cain and Abel story before Cain and Abel. And but she, with the help of Thoth, the god of wisdom, put Osiris's body back together after he'd been carved into 14 pieces. She could not find the one piece, the penis, but that didn't stop her from giving an immaculate conception to Horus about 2,500 years before Christ. This is the representation of the old religion. You have a scale of justice. You got a dreadlock lawyer. You got an African judge in a white robe. You got the jury of the African gods. And the judgment of Osiris was, if your heart was as light as a feather when you died, meaning if you hadn't violated any of the 42 negative commandments, then you would be granted eternal life. Otherwise, you'd be eaten by the monster, which was a combination of alligator, crocodile, and hippopotamus, which are the big time killers in Africa, even to this day. A representation of the Grand Temple of Amun-Ra. This is why people still say amen today. But the temple began to be built in 2000 BC, and over 500 pharaohs over the next 1500 years made additions and renovations to it until Egypt finally fell around 525 BC. This is the ship of Khufu, which was buried next to the Great Pyramid. His ship basically indicates that, you know, he got around, you know. And this is the Temple of Luxor. We're in Luxor here. And this temple was theoretically built by Ramses II, you know, around about 1200 BC. And I've been there, and it's a fantastic place. This is basically just a representation of what the Egyptian empire used to look like, you know, back in the day, basically. And that's why they had such influence. I mean, in the Iliad, there was an Egyptian prince, Agamemnon, who fought at the Battle of Troy. And there's a whole, you know, connected stories and histories about that. If anybody ever had the chance to see the golden mask of King Tut, I remember it came to Seattle when, this is about 1978, I first saw it. And I remember standing next to it, and a little young boy was asking about his father, about the beard that Tut had that only grew on his chin. And anyway, my beard grows like that. It's only on the chin. I can't grow a full beard, but the chin grows. The point being, Africans did not commence as slaves. And this is a tomb painting of a tomb in Kemet. And the tombs are fascinating. I mean, they were to me to show how sophisticated and urbane they were. And of course, that they were indeed people of color, brown and black people. Statue of the god Osiris.
Lost your volume. The volume is lost.
Oh, how did I do that?
Okay. Yeah, please continue.
Yeah, okay. We're just moving on. This is a DNA chart basically showing that, you know, really modern humans only developed about 120,000 years ago. But there are earlier forms of humanity, Neanderthals and Cro-Magnons and that sort of stuff. But the migration of the modern humans is more recent. And this is Oppenheimer's chart of, you know, the expansion and exploration of Africans out of Africa and then into Asia. And then they whip back around into Western Asia. You know, in all of the Egyptian stories, there's no mention of Europe. Europe is a fiction. There's no continent of Europe, really, but politically, we call Western Europe Asia, but the Egyptians, the Kemites, they call all the people in the north in that continent Asians. Another DNA chart, just basically showing the inherent DNA relationships of all humanity from a common root. And another look at this kind of has to do with climate change and the routes that people took to get around. 12,000 years ago, they say the levels of the oceans were 400 feet lower. We're talking about climate change now with the oceans rising up and the glaciers melting and stuff like that. Well, all of that has to do with the evolution of human migrations. With those changes in the coastline, people are able to move around. And then when things change, you know, things change and you got to move too. But this is talking about a Newsweek article I found 20 years ago talking about was the Sahara, the Garden of Eden. When there was an ice age in Europe, the Sahara was livable and green, but it eventually dried out. Over in, there's a place called Nabta, about 300 miles west of the Nile, that they found stone megaliths showing that the people were charting the stars. And they were charting the stars to see when the Sirius star was coming up, because the Sirius star heralded the flood of the Nile. And agriculture was based upon the floods of the Nile and stuff like that. But they were tracking that Sirius star then. At Nabta is the banks of an old lake that showed that people basically were watering their cattle there for thousands of years. And there are temples and complexes there that are based upon cattle cults. And many of these megaliths and things were taken to the new Nubian Museum. But in cave carvings in the Sahara, they show giraffes and lions and tigers and all kinds of animals that were living in the Sahara before it dried up and people moved around. This is what people look like in New Guinea. You know, the people in New Guinea are black and brown people, and they look, you know, pretty much just like different types of Africans. But the Melanesian Sea, I mean, all of the people in the South Pacific originally, you know, were black people. I mean, Fiji, Tonga, all those places, New Hebrides and all that stuff. These are black people. And like I say, in the Fiji Museum, they claim and recognize that they originally came, you know, from Africa. This is Oppenheimer's book that I found out. I was in the airport in South Africa, flying out of Johannesburg, and picked up this book, fascinating book, and breaks down the DNA. But he also talks about climate change and things like that. And this is the picture of the Laplander, black settlers in the far north of Europe. And you find people, you know, with dreadlocks and tan brown skin. Pharaoh Zoser. Zoser built the first pyramid, and his statue, this is in the Cairo Antiquities Museum, but I shot this picture. His nose is busted, his lips are full, and his dreadlocks are beautiful. Queen Ti, she was a paramount pharaoh, She was the wife of Amenophis III. And there's another statue of him and her, which is the biggest statue in the Cairo Antiquities Museum. Amenophis III was a magnificent pharaoh who left a lot of magnificent statues and mausoleum tombs. But their son was Akhenaten, who was famous for being a monotheist, and he was very controversial. And his son was King Tut, the last of the pharaohs. This is what you see when you go down in the tombs. This was the tomb of Ramses VI. When I shot that picture, showing that they certainly depict themselves as African people, brown people. And this is a statue of King Tut that was taken out of the King Tut's tomb. This one doesn't travel, but I shot this in the Cairo Antiquities Museum, where I visited and had the chance to see all of the King Tut memorabilia, which is in our video series we have. If you tap into AfricanHistoryVideos.com, our website, you know, there's a link to that. And this is a chapel built at least 4,000 years ago. This is the beginning of the Grand Temple of Amun-Ra, which was rebuilt by this guy. This is Senwosre I. He was a pharaoh of the 11th dynasty, long about 2000 BC. And legends of Sesostris race basically having him ranging with his armies far and wide, north and south. This is the Temple of Isis. This is a Nubian temple. In fact, when we were having the civil rights movement in the 60s, UNESCO, well, Egypt was raising the Aswan Dam. And so UNESCO started the mission to save the 24 ancient Nubian temples. And the Temple of Isis was one, the Temple of Abu Sembel is another. But this temple was carved up and then moved 50 miles north to another island. And that's where we visited it then and there. Now the legends of Isis are just many and manifest. This is a representation of Thoth, the African god of wisdom. And I reflect that children should be taught about this character, this mythology, this African mythology, because, you know, even though my mother was a teacher, she didn't teach me about the African god of wisdom. She was teaching me more Western things that were tinged with, frankly, white supremacy messages like Little Black Sambo and such. This is a compilation of pictures from a video that I'm working on the ancient Egyptian obelisks that were taken to Rome by emperors Caligula, Constantine, Diocletian, and they put them first up in front of, some of them were placed in front of temples of Isis, another was placed in front of the Circus Maximus, where they had chariot races. But later, after Rome fell, was overrun by the Goths and the Visigoths along about 500 AD, 479 AD. Anyway, Rome fell 1,000 years later, 1500, popes resurrected these obelisks and then started placing them in front of the Vatican, in front of the Cathedral of San Gregorio, which is where Constantine founded Catholicism. And so I'm tying the stories of the obelisks with the emperors, with the pharaohs that originally carved them and dedicated them to their gods, with the popes that took them later, maybe 3,000 years later, and exorcised them of the ancient religion of the Kemites, the sun god, and then dedicated them to Catholicism. And this guy, the Horemaket Sphinx, Horus on the horizon, this was dedicated to Horus. The legends of the Sphinx go back many times, but Horus was the son of Isis and part of that original Holy Trinity. And Howard Carter opening up the golden sarcophagus of King Tut, 600 pounds of solid gold and dressed magnificently. And he was just a minor king who died at the age of 19. This was some beautiful representations of King Tut and his wife that came out of his tomb over, 3,300 years ago, or 3,300 years old are these symbols. And this is a symbol of the old religious trinity of Osiris, Isis, and Horus, the Holy Family. That's me at the Grand Temple, just exploring the Grand Temple of Amun-Ra. That's me about to go down into King Tut's tomb. This is a statue I shot over in Turin, Italy. I went to Rome doing that video on the Egyptian pharaohs and the obelisks and into the Vatican, and I was really disappointed by the stuff that I saw in the Vatican. It was interesting, but in the Vatican, the display on Kemite really was about the last pharaoh who was really overthrown by the would have been Assyrians and the Persians. But anyway, this was, I don't know if it was a prince of Rome or a gentleman of Rome, but he just looked so, so beautiful. And this is the Grand Temple of Amun-Ra. It was started with that small chapel, but each of 500 pharaohs made additions over 1500 years. And it's just magnificent. The aisle goes straight down. When you go down to the back of it, about a mile, you can still look straight down that aisle. And this is across the river from the Valley of the Kings and Queens, King Tut's tomb. This is a representation of Sesostris, which would be the that's the Greek name for Senwosre the First. And he was a warrior king. There's all kinds of legends, but just Google Sesostris and you will be really surprised. This is, I'm sorry that this is blurry, but it's from a video shot that I did on my trip to Fiji. I call it the Fiji-Thebes connection. And in the Fiji National Museum, I videoed this plaque saying that according to their oldest oral traditions, they originally came from Thebes, Egypt, and the people migrated and then populated the South Pacific, the Melanesian Sea, and the people from Fiji, and then continued to move up and then came up into Hawaii. And that's what I saw in their museum. This is a statue of Thutmose III that I shot in the British Museum. It's beautiful. But Thutmose III was King Tut's great-great-great-granddaddy. And while King Tut had a two-room tomb, Thutmose III had a 24-room tomb, which is magnificent, but it's also been tomb-raided and stripped. But you can just imagine, you know, the gold and the wealth that might have been in Thutmose III's tomb compared to King Tut's. And this is a picture of a panel I shot in the British Museum of a Nubian princess in the chariot giving offerings and a visit to Pharaoh of Egypt. And this is, I'm sorry it's so small, but this is a cave painting from inside the Sahara that's been dated back to around 8,000 BC, showing that people were living in the Sahara, hunting antelopes and other animals that were living there. They say the Sahara really changed around 5400 BC, that the Lake Nabta dried up and the people, you know, when your lake dries up and your water dries up, then people have to move. That's Daphne and I visiting the ruins of another temple. Now, this is the temple called Wadi Yassabua, which means Valley of the Lions. And this was another temple that was carved up and saved by UNESCO and moved to higher ground. When the Nile was raised, 30 ancient Nubian cities were flooded. And in those cities, there was a lot of archaeological work going on. And they found symbols of kingship up in the south of Egypt that were carried down to the Nile. Because you got to remember that Narmer-Missus came from the south and then conquered the north and unified the country. Representation of the god Amun. And this is why people still say amen today. Representation of early Jesus Christ before the Reformation. Another representation of early Jesus Christ before the Reformation. And this is a representation of Mary and Jesus. This one is in a cathedral in Paris. This is a picture of Meroe, and this is Kush, and this was Nubia, and there are more pyramids actually in Meroe than there are in Egypt, but they were younger, newer. These were built between, I would say, 1000 BC and about 10 or 100 AD. I don't know why that jumped. But that's a representation of the fall of Egypt. Cambyses enslaving Pestamac, the last pharaoh who was ultimately murdered, representation of Jesus, not Jesus, but Moses from Russia. And Zipporah was the Kushite Nubian wife of Moses. I mean, it's obviously, this is a representation of an Ethiopian woman, wife of Moses, Zipporah. Caracalla. Caracalla was the son of Septimus Severus. Septimus Severus was the North African general who became emperor of Rome in 191 AD. Somebody cut the throat of the emperor, and then the three major generals of Rome fought it out to be who would succeed. And it turns out that all three of those generals were of African extraction. Septimus Severus made a deal with the strongest one and promised him that he would be his successor. And then he turned on the weaker one and killed him. And then he turned on the stronger one that he'd made a deal with and killed him too. And so that's how Septimus Severus became emperor. Caracalla was his son who succeeded him along with his brother, Gaia, whom Caracalla killed. But the baths of Caracalla still stand in Rome, and they cover over a block. And I visited there when I was shooting that movie, shooting my documentary on the obelisk. And this is a representation of a Black judge of justice in China, going back thousands of years, to say that my old friend Renoko Rashidi, who we brought to Hawaii to talk about African history, Black history, several times, first time in the 80s. But anyway, Renoko Rashidi wrote books on the African presence in Asia. And he says that the first Chinese dynasty, the Shang dynasty, were actually little Black men. And they're represented in the art there.
Let me interject for a minute, Andre. I don't know. Renoko passed away. Last year, in the last 3 months, while he was away in Africa doing some tours, you know, doing his historic lecturing, and he passed just recently.
Yeah. But his books, Renoko worked with Ivan Van Sertima on the Journals of African Civilization, and his specialty really was African presence in Australia and Asia. Renoko was the one that showed me the that picture of the Black samurai that goes back 1,000 years. This is another representation of Black Madonna and Child, representation of St. Morris. And you can Google St. Morris, and the United States military still gives awards in the name of St. Morris, the military saint, to this day. But this is Middle Ages, showing that, you know, Africans didn't come to Europe at first as slaves. They were soldiers in the Roman army. Many of the Roman soldiers were from Nubia, West Africa, and some of them were generals. And this is another representation of St. Morris. Black people in China. Black people in China. I mean, there's not a whole lot of talk about it, but they're there. And this picture is over 100 years old. Representation of Torak. 7-Eleven Torak with 15,000 Moorish cavalry crossed the isthmus from North Africa to Spain. They say when he crossed the isthmus, he burned his ships and said, "There'll be no retreat. We will kick ass or die." And they kicked ass, and they took Spain, killed Roderick, the king of Spain. Even though he had a lot more men, they trapped him in a valley and took him. And so that led to 800 years of Moorish rule, which ended in 1492 when Granada, the last Moorish kingdom, Spain, fell. And that, and then that led to the Inquisition, Spanish Inquisition, rooting out all the Moors and the Jews from Spain. And some say that really is the basis and foundation of white supremacy today. This was just an interesting book that I read. Stephen Barnes is a science fiction historical guy. But this is talking about if Granada hadn't fallen and if the Moors hadn't been run out of Spain, what would the world history be like? This is a representation of a Black Knight in Europe during the Middle Ages. And this, you know, rather speaks for itself in terms of the people in Mexico, the people in the New World, the people that they say are Indians or were renamed Indians that they say are red people. Well, that red and brown is the same that you see in Black people all around the world. And so basically, the Spanish had their whole religious agenda with them. And the Spanish in Mexico, they were said to spend a lot of time burning Mexican books and raiding Mexican libraries and destroying their history. And this one, it's a famous picture. Some of this writing was put on there. But anyway, Moor is Latin for Black. And so, I mean, the Moors were everywhere. This is a representation in a church in Russia. The Russians and the Greeks and some of the European religions, the Orthodox religions, still use the original symbols of the saints, and those symbols are Black people. Whereas in the Reformation, Martin Luther, 1500, they were started whitewashing stuff. And this is a representation that I shot down in Jamaica. Sam Sharp, he led the revolution to end slavery in Jamaica. He got hung for it, but the British Parliament did pass legislation to gradually phase out slavery in Jamaica. This was shown to me by Renoko Rashidi at first, maybe 20 years ago, when we brought him to Honolulu back around 1988. And anyway, there's supposed to be a movie coming out about Black samurai in Japan soon. You can see, you know, a big afro, you know, a big sword. And this was a breastplate of a suit of armor, actually, I'm told. King Kamehameha. The overthrow of the Hawaiian monarchy certainly was a power grab, but it was also a racist move. Black people in Korea, I believe. This is a wedding party in Seoul, Korea, 1900. And I never knew there were Black people in Korea before the US Army got there. Did you?
No.
That is a cartoon about Queen Liliuokalani being attacked and basically put in house arrest and treated disrespectfully. A West African knight. The interesting thing about that sword is that Columbus wrote that when he went to the New World, there were Black people over there who he saw coming back, sailing in large ships going back to West Africa. And the people that Columbus dealt with showed him spearheads. And that those spearheads were made out of a combination of gold and silver and another metal. But it supposedly the metal composition of those spearheads were the exact same as the ones that Columbus encountered and brought back to Spain as part of his vision. And this is just an early map of, that would represent Mansa Musa, the king of Mali. We really didn't get into Ghana, Mali, and Songhay very much, but the king of Mali and the kings of Songhay were known to be gold traders. They were reputed to have gold mines and rule nations that were primarily the gold traders. And there's a symbol of an Arab person coming to deal with Mansa Musa for the gold. And so Europeans, to a large extent, you know, were locked out of the gold trade. Think about it. Where are the big gold mines in Europe? Where are the big gold and diamond mines in Europe? I can't think of any. Can you?
No.
But the Europeans were jealous of the African people, and the Arabs kept them from this trade. And so they developed their maritime skills to go around the Arabs to get to the gold, and to India and places like that. But this map was said to be found in Paris around about 1350 AD. And this is a representation of Askia Muhammad. He was the sultan and the ruler of the Songhai. And the Songhai was the last great empire of West Africa. They were Muslims. I read an interesting book called The Badass Librarians of Timbuktu. And they talk about the history of Timbuktu, and they talk about the fact that they had to hide their manuscripts. After Gaddafi fell, a lot of thugs and crazies came out of Algeria, and Timbuktu and Mali was attacked. Mali is still going through changes as a result of Obama's decision to take out Gaddafi. There has been a lot of instability in North Africa as far as those governments. This is a representation of a Moor during the Middle Ages, the Dark Ages in Europe, when Othello and other representations of Moors were respected. This is a representation of Alexander de Medici. De Medici was the son of a rich Italian, and I believe his mistress or maid. He was obviously, what they say, Hapa mixed, but he was a ruler in Italy until he was murdered. And this is one of the kings of the Ashanti, Kumasi, Ghana. And Daphne and I visited Ghana 10 years ago, and we're fortunate enough to have dinner with the king of the Ashanti. Fascinating story. But he's got a hole in the ground that they've been pulling gold out of for the last 130 years. And they're still digging because they can still see the gold. The University of Ghana at Kumasi specializes in mining. The King of the Ashanti, they have a gold company. It's called the Anglo-Ashanti Gold Company. It's traded on the New York Stock Exchange under the symbol AU, which is the symbol for gold. And when the King of the Ashanti steps out in formal occasions, boy, the brother's covered in gold. This is an interesting book about the 100-year war for the British to fight their way into the Ashanti. And it took them 100 years, five generations. It was not an overnight affair. This is a painting of the city of Benin in 1600. The large figure is the King of Benin, and there's the town behind him, which was surrounded by a great wall. And this is a tomb painting, or a ruined tomb in Kemet. This is one of the Olmec heads, from Mexico, dating back to 1200 BC. There are at least 18 of them that have been dug up. And there's an interesting, Ivan Van Sertova wrote a book about it called They Came Before Columbus. And there's a nice YouTube show I saw about a brother looking for the African presence in Mexico and visiting La Venta, where there's a museum that displays many of these Olmec heads. This is a painting of St. Augustine. St. Augustine was from North Africa, and he was one of the early popes. The Confessions of St. Augustine are some of the early Catholic principles and philosophy. And he was a North African brown guy. This is a representation of people, brown people in early Japan. The Ainu people in Japan have an interesting history, and it is said that they were there before the invasion of the majority of the people in Japan now. The Ainu are in the far north of Japan, and they are the indigenous people of Japan. This is a picture of the people in Tierra del Fuego. Tierra del Fuego is the very tip, southern tip of South America. And this is what the people looked like when Magellan and the early Spanish explorers first visited Tierra del Fuego. And obviously they look like African people. This is a representation of Crispus Attucks. Crispus Attucks is said to have been the first person to die fighting for America in the Revolutionary War, 1776. This is a representation of Gabriel Prosser. Around about 1802, maybe he heard something about the Haitian Revolution, but in any case, Gabriel Prosser tried to free the slaves in Virginia, and he scared the crap out of a bunch of slaveholders and eventually got hung and murdered. This is my father's graduation picture from Tuskegee Flight School. The Air Force is using Daddy's picture on recruiting posters to this day. You may have seen the picture in backgrounds of movies. I think, was it Maya Angelou had Daddy's picture on her wall? And in that movie, any of you seen the Godfather of Harlem series? They got my daddy's picture there too. And that was Huey P., one of my favorites. This is Ida B. Wells. Ida B. Wells was a journalist and a freedom fighter. She specialized in documenting lynchings. And she was one of the founders of the NAACP, along with W.E.B. Du Bois and others. This is James Beckwith. James Beckwith was African-American and part Native American explorer, and he led wagon trains, and he wrote books. I think he's on a stamp. He was a badass dude. You can see he's got a knife, he's got a pistol, he's got a long gun. I mean, you know, he could defend himself. He could defend himself, took scalps. And these are generals of Ethiopia who fought the Italian invasion of 1896. And they were victorious there, defeating the Italians until Mussolini came back in 1936. But this is a representation of a Khalifa. And there's a claim that California was named after a queen, a black queen named Khalifa, who was in California when the Americans came. Remember, California was a Mexican state. United States took all those southern western areas. And we all know who these folks were, great freedom fighters. This is a picture of the Battle of Adowa. 1896, when the Ethiopians defeated the Italian invaders. And when I was in Rome, there was actually a plaque dedicated to the at least 600 Italians who were killed in this battle. And when the Ethiopians turned back their invasion. This is a representation of Vladimir Guerrero. Vladimir Guerrero was the second president of Mexico. In fact, he fought the war with Spain to free Mexico, which is why he became famous. His family was a family of armorers. I mean, in terms of they made guns. This is another representation of Vladimir Guerrero. Another thing about Vladimir Guerrero is when he was president of Mexico, he ended slavery in Mexico in 1822. Slavery was ended in the United States. The Emancipation Proclamation freed the slaves in rebellion in 1863, but Mexico had freed slaves two generations before that. And that's significant because that's why the Battle of the Alamo was actually fought, because the Kentuckians and the Americans were bringing in enslaved people to work the lands that they were colonizing in Mexico at the time. And that was against the law in Mexico. And they wouldn't stop doing it. And so the Mexican army led by Santa Anna came back and said, no, there's no slavery in Mexico. So that's what the Battle of the Alamo was really fought for. And we're being told all kinds of lies about it. Same thing about the Civil War. They want to say it was about states' rights. Well, the states' right to do what? The states' right to have slaves. This is a representation, actually a picture of a stained glass window at Yale University in the lunchroom of Black folks picking cotton. And that stained glass window was destroyed by a Black employee there on his as part of his quitting that job, basically. But my point is that some of these so-called prestigious white institutions of learning were teaching messages of white supremacy and racism along with their business schools, which, you know, there was a lot of interchange between Southern states and these Northern institutions, J.C. Calhoun, slave owners and stuff. The version of capitalism that they were teaching was that cold-blooded slavery type capitalism that still leaves vestiges in some of these institutions that have to be looked at, examined, and eradicated. That's me visiting an ancient Nubian temple. I'm at the Wadi Es Sabua, which is the Valley of the Lions, which is an interesting name for a temple. But this was one of the 24 temples of UNESCO that was saved. This temple was carved up and then moved to higher ground when the Aswan Dam was raised and 300 miles and 30 ancient Nubian cities were flooded. And so these temples are the only remaining evidence of these ancient Nubian temples, some and the cities, some of them existed long before Egypt became a nation. One of these temples that was carved up and moved was taken to New York City. So when you go to the Metropolitan Museum, which I hope you do, because they do have a fantastic Egyptian collection there, and check that out, the Egyptian temple there is actually a Nubian temple. And that was the last of my slideshow.
Okay, you can unmute if anyone have any questions of Andre. We can unmute and ask him questions.
Stop the share, Andre.
Hello?
Yes, yeah, stop the share up top, the red button. Okay. Thank you. Thank you so much for standing behind and letting us all get to see the beautiful slides that you had prepared. Thank you.
My pleasure. Thank you, this has been fun.
Any questions or comments, you can unmute yourselves.
I really want to thank Amina from the Bronx for coming out joining us today. She's a world of history herself, you know, and I love this lady. She's really in my corner. Thank you so much, Hermina.
All right, thank you all. I would like to get the, so we're gonna have to put the pictures with the audio. Is that the audio was saved, but not the, interesting.
No, what, let me stop the recording right now. No, what we have is this.
Okay.
What we have is we should have the full presentation.
Andre Wooten, our keynote speaker, please come back. And if you have any closing thoughts, please.
Well, just, the brother was talking about Malcolm X recently. And recently, two of the brothers that were locked up for 25 years for killing Malcolm X were exonerated, you know.
Yikes.
And so and the one brother who admitted being part of it, he's dead. And so the whole thing was a government cover-up. I mean, there's so much information that really hasn't been pursued about why the police were diverted. There were Black officers who were part of the security detail of Malcolm X normally, who were told to go someplace else. And so, you know, Malcolm X is still in the news, and the recent exoneration of those people, you know, just shows, you know, what a travesty it was. He was about to get international, you know, with his movement for human rights for African Americans, and somebody didn't want him approaching the UN.
Aloha. This special events program is brought to you by the Law Office of Attorney Daphne Barbie and the Office of Attorney Andre Wooten. We hope you enjoy it. Mahalo.